Hello, the students, and welcome to your chemistry lesson. Today we'll be starting the topic, the atom. Under this lesson, we'll be looking at the definition of an atom, the subatomic particles, the structure of an atom, and last but not the least, the nuclide representation. What is an atom? Well, an atom is simply the smallest unit of an element that is able to participate in a chemical reaction. An atom is the smallest unit of an element that can take part in a chemical reaction. You should always remember that an atom is invisible and cannot be seen. However, when many atoms combine chemically, they may form a visible product. When many atoms combine chemically, they may sometimes form a visible product. For example, this picture shows a product of the combination of atoms. In the picture, we can see diamonds, right? I guess you knew them immediately the picture came up. If you didn't, those are diamonds. Diamonds are made up of carbon atoms. So when carbon atoms combine chemically under some certain conditions, they form diamonds. So diamonds can be a way we can know that atoms really are present, because diamonds only contain carbon atoms. Now, like I just said, when atoms combine, they form products that may be visible. These products that are formed are elements. That is, elements are made up of many atoms of one type. Though diamond cannot be said to be an element, when atoms that are the same combine, they will form elements. For example, in the diagram here shows the different types of elements known and used in chemistry. There are 103. If you see the last number there is 103. Yes, so each of these elements only contains one type of atom. So, for example, in the hydrogen element, there are only hydrogen atoms. Now, let's look at the second part in this lesson, which are the subatomic particles. We earlier said atoms are invisible, right? Yes. But now, due to recent scientific research, it's been proven that atoms contain particles inside their bodies. These particles that are contained inside the atoms are the particles known as subatomic particles. There are mainly three subatomic particles that are known. The first one is the proton, which is denoted by small letter P, the electron, which is denoted by small letter E, and the neutron, which is denoted by small letter N. If you want to remember these three subatomic particles, just remember the word pen. As you can see, they make the word pen, P-E-N. With that said and done, let's look at more about these subatomic particles. Protons are found at the center of the atom. They are positively charged and have mass of one atomic mass unit. Protons are found at the center of the atom. and they are positively charged. Don't forget these things we're looking at now, as they will be very important sometimes when you're dealing with questions that pertain the atom. Now, electrons are found in the shell of the atom. They are negatively charged and have a mass of 1 over 1840. This mass is consideredly zero. So basically, electrons are said to have zero mass. Now we're left with one subatomic particle. If you can remember our mnemonic pen, you know that the subatomic particle left is the neutron. Neutrons are also found at the center of the atom, and they have no charge but have a mass of one atomic mass unit. As you can see, all the subatomic particles that are heavy are found at the center. The neutron is found at the center, and the proton is found at the center, and both have one atomic mass unit. So this takes us to four facts about atoms. Don't forget these four facts, as they may also be helpful to answer some questions that concern the atom. The first fact is that mass is concentrated at the center of an atom. Like I said, this is because the protons and neutrons are the subatomic particles that are found at the center. Then we should also note the second fact, which says the center of an atom is positively charged. Why? Because of the two subatomic particles that are found in the center, only protons have got a charge. Neutrons do not have any charge. I guess they got the name neutrons from neutral. When something is neutral, it bears no charge. The third fact is that the shells of an atom are negatively charged. You agree with me? This is because the shells contain electrons, and electrons are negatively charged. Last but not the least, the atom is neutral. Why do they say the atom is neutral? This is because the number of protons are always equal to the number of electrons for any atom, unless it needs to be bonded with another atom and form many different compounds. With that said and done, now let's look at the structure of an atom. The diagram here shows the structure of an atom. The center of the atom is known as the nucleus. So the protons and neutrons sometimes may be referred to as the nucleons. Then we've got spherical structures that are around the nucleus, which are known as shells or energy levels. So you now get the understanding when we say protons and neutrons are at the center, while electrons are found in the shells. Yes, so to say that again, the nucleus is found at the center of an atom, and the nucleus is made up of protons and neutrons, while the shells or energy levels are spherical structures around the nucleus where we find the electrons. Now, we go to the last part of this lesson, the nucleide representation. What is the nucleide representation? Well, the nucleide representation is just the format in which elements are written. So you saw the periodic table earlier in this lesson. So the way those elements are written is called the nucleide representation. So if you can remember, there were some numbers and there were some letters, right? Yes. So we'll look at what each of those three parts there mean. So a nucleide representation basically contains the atomic number, atomic mass number, and the symbol of the element. We'll start with looking at the atomic number. The atomic number is denoted by the letter Z when we're just talking about the nuclide representation, that is not concerning any of any element. It's like when we talk in mathematics where we've got variables, right? Yes, we don't have any numbers, but those variables can be any number. So the nuclide representation is also like just a copy of any element. The values can change and the symbols can change. So now the atomic number is simply the number of protons in the atom that makes an element. We said an element is made up of many atoms that are one type, right? Yes. So now the atomic number, which is denoted as Z, is simply the number of protons in the atom that makes up that element. The atomic mass number, which is denoted by A, is simply the sum of the protons and the neutrons that are in the nucleus of the atoms that make up the element. You know where the nucleus is, right? At the center. Yes, so the atomic mass number is the sum of protons and neutrons. Or simply, when you add the protons and neutrons, you get the value of the atomic mass number. Sometimes the atomic mass number can be called the nucleon number, or simply the number of nucleons present in an atom. This brings us to the last but not least part of the nuclide representation, which is the symbol of the element. The symbol of the element will be denoted by the letter X. The symbol of an element is simply the letter or letters that are used to abbreviate that element. So enough of talking now, let's look at how the nuclide representation looks like. So that's the nuclide representation. In this example, we're not talking about any of an element, right? This does not symbolize any element, but it just helps us to remember what each of the parts of a nuclide representation mean. So we said the X is the symbol, right? Yes. So this is where we'll find the letter that abbreviates or symbolizes an element. While where there's A, this is where we'll find the atomic mass number, the protons plus the neutrons. While where there's Z is where we'll find the atomic number, or simply the number of protons. So here's an example of the nuclide representation of nitrogen. You find this on the periodic table if you search for nitrogen. This is how nitrogen is represented. So the 7 just tells us nitrogen has got 7 protons, while the 14 tells us nitrogen has got the nucleon number of 14, or the atomic mass number of 14, meaning nitrogen has got 7 protons and 7 neutrons. This is because the nucleon number will give us the proton number plus the nucleon number, the neutron number. So when we add the protons and neutrons, we get A. And A, in the case of nitrogen, is 14. I'm sure you'll be asking, what are the number of electrons? Well, like we said, all atoms are neutral. So the number of protons is equal to the number of electrons. And hence, for nitrogen, there are 7 electrons. You should note that atoms that make up elements may have the same atomic mass number. However, no two different atoms will have the same atomic number. So there can be two elements with the same number on A, but they can't be two elements with the same number on Z. That brings us to our last point that we should note. Each element has got its own symbol, and no two different elements have the same one. So that's all for today's lesson. You can review the video to get each and every concept understood, and look out for our next chemistry video, which will be talking about more on the atom.